Hi, everybody. I'm Dr. Chris Tayor. This is my friend here, Dr. Frank Barker. I'm here with him today doing an interview, and I wanted just to start asking him a few things here. He has meant a whole lot in my life, our ministry bridge work, and also our churches around here. He's helped a lot of us in many ways. I wanted to ask you, what do you think would be, if somebody's doing a research on those things, you know, following Christ, discipleship, and church, what would be a good question to ask about that?
Well, a good question to ask is, where are some books or groups that do discipleship, do that type thing, and have developed this over the years, like the Navigators, people like that who developed very helpful tools on discipleship. And of course, people do discipling in different areas, like one would be in the church, but another might be on a college campus or wherever, and there'd be some variation in things like that. And but basically, the principles would be the same of getting people into the Word and into interaction with each other and outreaching to others and all that type thing. You've got a lot of basic principles to cover, but it would vary somewhat according to the groups we were working with. And of course, if it's overseas or reaching out to internationals here, it would vary some in terms of just how to best approach it and that type thing.
So you're saying there, clarify, if you want to ask anything about what's going on today in the church, in the discipleship, you need to look at these other, maybe books about or groups?
Yes, and just see what tools they're using that might apply to your situation. I know when I started discipling, one thing that really helped me, we had a fellow, Chuck Singletary, who was with the Navigators, who moved here, and he began discipling people, and I began to watch what he was doing and said, hey, we need to multiply that. And that was very, very helpful and so on.
By the way, he's the one who came and helped me too.
Oh, good.
At the time I started, he took me up there to the Navigator Castle.
Oh, wow.
So, but let me ask you this. In your time of following Christ, what do you hope has been the result of your ministry?
Well, I hope the result of my ministry has been many people developing their gifts. When you joined Briarwood, you of course went through a membership class, and part of that was one of the things you did was try to read through about the different gifts and answer questions that would help you locate your gifts and what you felt your gifts were. And then we would try to help you develop those gifts and start using them. And you know, one person got a gift of teaching, another person got a gift of administration. One of the best things I ever did was hire a church administrator, Tom Leopard, and others to help me, because I wasn't a good administrator. And so to figure out what your gifts are and then how to best develop them and help your people do that, I think that's very helpful.
That's good. So even from inside of a church, you know, discipleship, you see God has given, not everybody does it the same thing in the process.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what you're saying there.
Yes.
If you had a message, I'm going to ask this sort of in two things. If you had a message to actually bring it to ministers, what would that be at this time of your life? What would be the message you want ministers of churches to hear?
Well, I think what I'd like to communicate to ministers, and have done it in different times, not too long ago, went down to Montgomery to a church down there to try to communicate this to them and all, as we want to get our people solidly grounded, and then we want to get them growing, and then we want to get them using their gifts and all. And so when people joined Briarwood, after a little while, I started where they'd go through four core courses. First was basic Christianity using John Stott's book and so on. And next was the basic disciplines of the Christian life. And then the next was the study of Romans, basic study of Romans, where you learn an outline of Romans. That's the most doctrinal book in Scripture, and get them doctrinally founded, your people who are joining the church. And they memorize key verses, memorize an outline and whatever. And they would study that and all. And then the last one was a study of the Westminster Confession of Faith, which was our doctrinal standard of our denomination. And then of course, we had, that was the basic stuff. And then we had them where we wanted to get them trained in evangelism. And we used different things. We've used campus outreach, not campus outreach, we used a Campus Crusade for Christ.
That's right.
Training, and then we've used Evangelism Explosion training by Jim Kennedy and those type things, and to get people equipped to share their faith, you know. And of course, they, according to their gifts, we have them sharing and working in different areas of the church. You know, if it's a gift of mercy, if it's a gift of teaching, if it's a gift of administration, whatever it may be, then try to get them using their gifts, and it can make a real difference when you do that.
Well, you're saying if you had one of the messages to focus on, you know, helping maybe a pastor of a church. Mm-hmm. Say that again. I mean, just to
help the pastor. Give him the idea of, okay, let's get them grounded, let's get them growing. When the basic disciplines of the Christian life, that'll get them growing and all. And then that learning that outline and all of Romans, so that gets them into the Scriptures solidly founded. And then the doctrinal standard, of course, of our denomination, but of different denominations, whatever it might be, where you've got a broad area there. The doctrinal standards are different things, you know. But get them with those things, and then they're pretty well off and running now. Let's take them, their gifts, and start channeling them into different areas there. But if the pastors will do that, get that going, why, it makes a big difference in their growth and in the church's growth.
Well, if you also had a message, say, I want this message here to focus on who my laymen are, on my laymen, what message would you say to laymen, businessmen in the church, or things like that?
Well, the message to the layman would be to, of course, be growing spiritually, the basic disciplines of the Christian life. Get them in a small group that would meet weekly or something. Give some training also about their families and how to raise their children and that type thing. And then get them involved in outreach in different ways. You know, we used to, we would, when I was pastor, we'd had everybody who visited the church would be invited to my home, the new visitors. Once a month we'd do that, and we'd have different people in the church who would be invited also with them, and they would intermix with them and build relationships with them and that type thing. Just the whole idea of drawing in. And then, of course, we constantly gave courses here on reaching out to others and inviting them to different fellowship things, inviting them to church and all. And we would have things that you could invite people to. Like, for instance, we just had a sportsman's banquet here this past weekend where people...
Oh, yeah, that's my kind of thing.
Yeah, people would bring their friends to hear this fellow speak about being a sportsman, going out and shooting different things, you know, and all. And so you'd bring them, but you'd weave the gospel into all of it, and they would come to the sportsman's banquet because that was what they were interested in. But now we begin to channel them in the right direction spiritually, you know.
evangelism standpoint, it's still a very big priority then for you.
Yes.
But you know, I don't want to talk much about me. I have a speech impediment, but it just so happens that that happened to be the strength that God had given me, that that opened doors from evangelism.
Wonderful.
And so that's why I wanted to actually understand, but because how do you see, this is not a change in topic, but this is sort of a focus. How do you see the focus on Christ's love for me and the following Christ, you know, come and die and be a disciple? How do you see those two things operating? How do you see that?
Well, Christ's love for me, God so loved the world, He gave His Son, and His Son gave His life for me, you know, and His love for me, certainly, I ought to love Him and want to carry out His will. Lord, if You give Your life for me, there's nothing, no sacrifice too great for me to make for You. And that needs to constantly be my thinking and kept before me, that motivates me to die to self and to seek to live for Him and for others, in a sense. If I can just think of how undone I was and how doomed I was and what He did for me and what it cost, my goodness, how grateful I should be. And then think of the need of others around me. They're in the shape, a lot of them, that I was in before God opened my eyes to the gospel. I was actually in seminary before I became a Christian. Always good if you can become a Christian before you get out of seminary. But I was pastoring a church on the weekends, and I knew something wasn't right, and I didn't feel like asking my congregation, how can you be sure you're a Christian? I didn't feel like asking my professors, but there was a Air Force chaplain at the seminary who was doing some postgraduate work, and I was Naval Air Reserves. He'd go flying with me, and I felt free to ask him, how can you be sure you're a Christian? He gave me a track that really opened my eyes spiritually. And then I began to use that to reach out to others. And I pastored the church for a year, and it didn't grow. But then when I became a Christian, it took off. It helps when the preacher becomes a Christian.
Yeah. What about, based on that, I've seen the churches say, you know, we need to preach more the love of Christ, mm-hmm. you know, all grace,
yeah.
grace. And so some have felt like, I mean, I've actually heard from people that some of the ministries, how would you answer the statement that sometimes a parachurch or discipleship type ministries have been too legalistic?
Well, we do want to emphasize the grace of Christ, but that doesn't mean that we don't need a lot of basic disciplines in terms of getting our people growing spiritually, and in terms, of course, of dealing with wrong things in the church. And so having a church discipline is a part of the practice that we need to implement and structure things for. Certainly we emphasize salvation is a gift, but also, we're to seek to obey God's law, and the evidence that we've really surrendered our will to Christ and put our trust in Him is that there's a growing trend of obedience in our lives. Faith without works is not true faith, you know, it's dead. And not, we're not saved by works, but the works evidence of salvation, and that's out of gratitude again.
So what do you, in your view, is the local church's greatest challenge is to making a disciple?
Well, I think that we do want to make disciples. Our church isn't going to be solidly reaching out and isn't going to be solidly growing unless we really are equipping our people and training them and making disciples out of them. And you just read the New Testament and see how Christ discipled His men and all that, you know, and they discipled others. He starts off with 12, and then he's got 72 that he sends out, and so on, you know. And so it's just real crucial. Discipleship is just right at the heart of our being effective. And when new people are brought to Christ and come in, they've got to be followed up right away. And it pretty much is, some of us in a group setting, but a lot of us one-on-one. So on, just depends on the situation.
The who or what do you feel like has greatest impact in your view of making disciples?
I think probably the navigators had the greatest impact in terms of when Chuck Singletary moved here and joined Briarwood and began discipling people, and I observed what he was doing. I said, ooh, we need to multiply that. And so I think the navigators helped me really get oriented that way. But of course also groups like Campus Crusade and then Jim Kennedy and all, with his evangelism outreach and getting out people sharing their faith, getting out people practicing the basic disciplines in their own life, you know, prayer, Christian fellowship, and Bible study and all that, the basic disciplines, getting them doing that and getting them in small groups and all, and train them in sharing their faith. So all that's real basic, that's really basic and important.
What do you feel like is the greatest sort of a danger of facing the church out there today?
The danger facing the church today is varied, I think. I think part of it, you get an element of it that's sort of hyper-grace or something like that. They're so emphasizing grace, they're not adequately emphasizing the discipline, they're not adequately emphasizing the obedience and so on. And they're sure salvation by grace, and that's wonderful, but don't neglect the commands of God, don't neglect the basic disciplines and so on. And so I think that's a real critical thing, is an overemphasis on grace. And then I think seems to me that there's a good bit of immorality just beginning to, in our culture, multiplying, and our people are kind of getting sucked into some of that, and we've got to stand up against the wrong things in our culture, like the transgender things and all that type stuff, and just amazing things that are being promoted today. Of course, abortion is awful, and I remember when it first came out with Roe versus Wade about abortion, I preached on that not long thereafter and how awful it was, and all. And I remember a gentleman in our church walked out and said to me, "That's, I got to do something about that. That's terrible." He went out and started Save a Life ministry, which now has saved hundreds of thousands of children all over the world, you know,
yes.
Man alive. Well, that's what we got to be doing, is dealing with our wrong in our culture and helping our people stand up against it and so on.
This is sort of a change, not a change, but just asking this. I've seen of this a lot, that some churches actually may view a parachurch as sort of, you know, again, sort of outside, and there's always has been a challenge in that sort of relationship. I remember the time I came on staff up here, campus outreach. I actually met Elliot Belcher at that time down there. He helped me a little bit, and you had called and helped me to raise support, and you said if you support, you know, if you're supporting him, you're supporting the church. Mm-hmm. Wondering how you view the parachurch, you know, ministries, the church. You know, what is a healthy view of that?
Well, I think, of course, campus outreach in one sense is not parachurch. It's under the church, but in another sense, it's parachurch. It's working all outside the church, all over, you know, and wonderfully. And we've had a number of ministries like that that we've started, but that's been a wonderful one there. And, you know, in some of those ministries, you think of the Navigators or something else, that's parachurch, but gosh, it's so helpful to the local church. And it doesn't have to be under the control of the local church to be very effective in its outreach. And you think of your, of course, as our denomination, we've got mission to the world, something like that, our missions outreach. But the other mission organizations, that are reaching around the world, we want to support both those that we are overseeing and those that others are overseeing. We want to support all of that. It's all excellent outreach, solidly grounded and all.
I even heard, before I came here at the time, I read an article I had you in it that said that y'all had supported so many missions, and which was a campus of crusade, and
yes,
one of the largest supporters. That's very parachurch. They're not necessarily a local church, mm-hmm, but they're out there focusing on an area. I wanted to ask you this, because some people ask this, and I think that there's a change in the mentality today. Some churches are afraid, we have to keep everything under the umbrella of the church. But I just wanted to ask what your thoughts are on that.
I don't think everything has to be under the umbrella of the church. And of course, once you get outside of being under the church, your theology gets a little different, maybe. Instead of Calvinism, it may be more Arminian or something else. If it's basic Christianity, that's solid, and you should back it anyway, I think, and because they're going to be reaching in some areas that others may not be able to reach in very well. A local church can't, or even a denomination can't, mm-hmm, do very well as much as a parachurch can. And so, by all means, we want to permeate the world, and locally and around the world, and it's going to take all kind of organizational structure.
Maybe the Army, Navy, Air Force, and
exactly,
the Marines,
Exactly. Good illustration.
But I think about that, one time I asked you on a board, and I talked about, I have a ministry that sort of does stuff in out there, and I don't want to make this focus on anything I'm doing, but ministry's out there, but there needs to be a bridge.
Yes.
A bridge to help things go to the church, but you have to set up something outside of the church.
Yes.
Because, I helped a local football team. I speak at the father-son breakfast. I started a thing there, but I couldn't bring the church in there, mm-hmm, but I had to do it, from a family values.
Yes.
But just speaking, if you're going to reach your neighbor over the fence, how do church and parachurch, how should they function side by side? That's the challenge,
Well, what we do as a church is we support our denomination. Mm-hmm. And of course our local church work and we've started things like campus outreach and other things that reach out beyond our local church area but still under the local church. But we also back people going with different mission organizations, the parachurch organizations, and the Navigators, the Campus Crusade, you name it, all the different missionary organizations. And we support them both, and we believe that works very well.
Another thought, then, this may get into sort of a touchy subject on that. There could be different agreements. Some people say giving our tithing needs to go a local church, and some say part of my tithe can go to a parachurch and part there to a local church, and some may say my giving goes all to a parachurch or my giving goes all to a local church. How do you speak about that?
Well, we would encourage our people to support both the local church and parachurch, and we of course have representatives of both at different conferences and things like that, and we'll often have a representative of a parachurch organization speaking at our church on different things. And certainly we want to encourage our people to consider going with that and supporting people with that. Our primary support would be of our local church and our local denomination, but we want to encourage the other too.
If you have a young life out there that's actually in your school. I know that they're at a Briarwood High School and doing things, and they're actually in the thing. But there's also a youth group here at the church.
Yes.
And so, I was actually part of a church in Arkansas that actually saw both operating. We had the NAVS, Crusade, and everybody attending the same church. That takes a unique pastor. What kind of a pastor needs to do that? I mean, what kind of view do you need to have?
Well, I think a pastor needs to see both as good work and a group like Campus Crusade or something being able to reach into areas that a local church couldn't reach into quite as well as they are probably, and so they should support that and work with that, and they can benefit from the training that the Campus Crusade group can give to your people too, and so it's good interaction to that type thing, and you learn from each other. I think it's beneficial.
This is actually, I now have a 22-year-old son. I asked him what he would ask you. You know, he's just now trying to figure it out. It actually makes me emotional to talk about that. You know, our children mean so much to us, you know.
Amen.
And he asked this. He said, is there anything that you would have done differently or have any regrets you may have?
Is there anything I would have done differently as a church leader? If I had it to do again? I don't know that I would have done anything different. We've just developed things as time came along, like campus outreach. I remember early on, I was trying to reach out in the city here, and there was a local, we were particularly trying to cross racial barriers and all, and there was another man in another church that had a similar desire, and he asked me to help him with different things, and he was meeting with some folks that he was working with racially and all, and he asked me to come sit in on the meeting, and as I did, I began to realize that what he was teaching was just really very, not very solid. And I thought, what have you been reading? I asked him, and boy, it was not good. And I thought, good night. He hadn't had any real good, solid training. And, you know, I wonder how many guys are like that. They want to reach out and do good, but they really hadn't had any good training. We need to make some good training available to them. And so I wound up got another pastor, and we started Birmingham Theological Seminary to train these people, and it's a little different from a typical seminary where you got to go off to the seminary or something. We'd bring the seminary to them, where we would have it here in the city, and they could attend it at night, at different nights of the week, like that. And so now we started Birmingham Theological Seminary, and now we are all over the state here with it in terms of Montgomery and Tuscaloosa and Anniston and Dothan and all over. Now it's getting ready to spread down to Florida and so on. You never know what's going to work out, but as you try reaching out, you begin to see different needs and how, you know, so in a sense that's interaction with others, and we got all kind of racial groups meeting in our seminaries and taking training and all, and that's so good to be able to do that. As we see the needs and then just try to reach out.
Could we ask you that? I guess as a discipler myself and being here in the public school, I've been helping Coach Anderson. I have a ministry, you know, Rich Van Houten's on my staff now.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's doing some stuff over at a school, and I've been helping Oak Mountain, so we get to speak at Best Davy in Oak Mountain. That's just one of the areas building a bridge, but it has seemed like it seemed a challenge. I just wonder how you would answer this. It seemed a challenge. It seemed like a lot of the ministry that we speak about sometimes at some of our churches is about, you know, a racial ministry or mercy ministry things. Mm. And it's not easy for us to actually show how we are connecting into our neighbors over the fence.
Yes.
So I'm wondering, how do we address that? That's one of the big things I had in my mind. How do we address in the community over the fence? How do we train our people to do that?
Well, I think if you can build some relationships with some people over the fence, and then have them come in and do some sharing with your congregation about different things, that begins to open your people up to the need and to the privilege, in a sense, and get them involved in it.
Like even bringing in a teachers from the public school.
Yeah.
Or bringing in maybe an officer, a police officer.
Yes.
That's not even at our
yes.
church.
Yes.
Like at this time, I have a group with I have five Catholic in it. Wow. We're attending a group at Oak Mountain. I've been helping Oak Mountain start a men's ministry, and they've asked me to. But, anyway, that's a great idea. Though I like that, you know, you got to interact rather
yes.
than them having to come to us. We invite them,
right.
or as they go.
Yeah.
So, one more thing here, and I really wanted to ask: what's one of the greatest challenges that you have faced in all of your time in following Christ?
One of the biggest challenges I faced in all my time of following Christ. Well, one of them was in our former denomination, when that denomination was getting so liberal that it was really tough, and we didn't really know what to do, and we would come together and talk about it, guys like myself, and we finally decided that we had to start another denomination, and there was a real risk of losing our property in the process, and that was before we were in this property here. We were at another location, but we finally decided to do it, and the congregation, I presented it to the congregation. The congregation was voting, and if you had one or two people of the congregation vote not to go, the denomination would sue for your property in the name of those two or something like that. And we had a unanimous vote. But that was a tough one, boy. And
Going through that.
Yeah, and I remember in the process of going through it, I thought, I started the church in 1960, and this was 1973. I thought, before that was voted, before I thought, 13 years of trying to do God's will, and I'm about to lose the whole thing.
Yeah.
You know, and that was a big decision. Yeah.
Help that. One other thing I'll ask, and how, I mean, some of this video may get out there. I'm just trying to help people gain some convictions or understand what others are convictions. So I don't want to place anyone at risk or, you know, put anything out there. But would you care to say a word how we can pray for you and your family personally, how you're doing and stuff like that?
Well, my wife's got some illnesses, and pray for her, if you would. And but my family is doing very well as far as they all the kids growing up are walking with the Lord. We got 12 grandchildren, and they're all walking with the Lord. And my children are involved in ministry, and then their children, a lot of them are involved in ministry. They're all walking with the Lord, and that's so exciting. And now we've got great-grandchildren starting off and all.
Mm.
But pray for our family.
I will. Yeah. By the way, your son-in-law, even, he spoke at one time at which is the Tim Towns.
Yeah.
He spoke at my campus one time.
Oh,
he's
great.
An exciting
great.
Guy. But your wife has had a big impact on my family and my
yeah.
wife.
Yeah.
I wanted to thank her because of that. Noah made up from the heart. You know, she would come to me because I have a speech impediment.
Mm-hmm.
And she would say, I know somebody else, but God's going to use you.
Amen.
And she was just so encouraging for me.
Amen. She was right.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Barker.
Thank you, brother. Great to be with you. See you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's good. I didn't know. I was a little nervous because of my interviewing ability. But
you're doing good.
I just appreciate how much you've meant to our ministry. I'll give you a copy of my latest thing. I have some pictures of when I was with Canvas Outreach. I have a whole history of 30 years. I made up a deal. And so, but you have been an incredible part of that. You're just a kingdom mentality. I know you spoke at the Baptist Church, the Episcopal Church. You know, you've gone to different churches. It was not about your ministry. And I have to say, if there's anything that I, there's only one reason I want to connect with you is because of that. And just, I don't see that very often these days among ministers all the time. And, but just, I wanted to thank you.
Thank you. You heard the one about the Baptist and the Methodist and the Presbyterian?
Huh.
Talking about what Jesus would be if he was alive today? The Methodist said, well, I think he'd be a Methodist. I said, why? Well, he told the parable of the Good Samaritan. We were in helping people in need. I think he'd be a Methodist. The Baptist said, well, I think he'd be a Baptist. Why? Well, he came to seek and save the lost. We were very evangelistic, so I think he'd be a Baptist. The Presbyterian said, well, I think he'd be a Presbyterian. You didn't say why. I just don't think he'd want to change.